Next topic for our discussion is denture-based resin. It would be covered under as what is denture-based resin, ideal requirements, methyl methacrylate, stages of polymerization, types of denture-based resin, properties of denture-based resin. And the denture-based resin is a part of the denture which rests on the soft tissue and so does not include the artificial tooth. Means the pink portion of any complete denture is called as a denture-based resin. The denture-based resin gets solidified and they polymerized. What is polymerization? Polymerization is a series of chemical reaction in which the macromolecule, means a bigger molecule that is called as a polymer, is formed from a large number of small molecules that is known as monomer. When n number of monomer mixes, n number of monomer comes together with any chemical reaction, the polymerization reaction starts and the polymer is formed. So, what are the ideal requirements for the denture-based resin to have? The denture-based resin should have the biological compatibility. It should have a sufficient strength in the form of compressive strength and the impact strength. It should be ease of manipulation. The denture-based resin should have ease of manipulation. It should have the aesthetic properties similar to the oral cavity. And it should be chemically inertized. It should not give any kind of chemical reaction to the oral tissues. And last but not the least, and it's an important topic that it should, an important point that it should be economical in nature. The denture-based resin, mostly methyl methacrylate is used as a denture-based resin in India as well as in the abroad. It is a polymerized, it can be polymerized either by heat, visible light, ultraviolet light, or by a chemical initiator. It exhibits a high vapor pressure and it's excellent organic solvent. Mode of supply. Generally, this particular methyl methacrylate is supplied in the form of powder and liquid, where the liquid is monomer, is supplied in a tightly sealed amber color bottle to prevent evaporation and for premature polymerization by light. Most of the time, during our spotting and even for the viva of the second BDS, the examiner asks you why the monomer is kept in amber color bottle. So you are supposed to know what is the reason to keep the monomer in the amber color bottle. That is to prevent evaporation of that material and to prevent premature polymerization. What are the stages of polymerization? The stages of polymerization are classified in two ways. Like first is chemical and second one would be the physical. When the stages of chemical stages of polymerization are induction, where the activation and initiation is happened and the generation of free radical is going to be there. When this free radical, the next step is propagation. When this free radical mix, they make a complex and that free radical complex to are aggregate together to form the dimer, which itself again then acts as a free radical. That reactive complex adds successively large number of molecules so that the polymerization continues throughout the propagation of the reactive center. So, whenever the small monomers are going to add, they are going to add by making a free radical, and the propagation they are supposed to continue the polymerization process. In the third step, chain transfer, the active free radical or of a growing chain is transferred to another molecule. For example, a monomer or a inactivated polymer chain, and a new free radical for the further growth is created. That is called as a chain transfer. And the fourth stage is termination. The termination is done either by direct coupling of two radical chain or by the exchange of hydrogen atom from the one growing chain to the another growing chain. So there are four chemical stages of polymerization, that is induction, propagation, chain transfer and termination. Now we are going to discuss about physical stages of polymerization. Now, the physical stages of polymerization are classified according to the stage of that particular material after the polymer and monomer are mixed. So, whenever the polymer and monomer are mixed, the first step is the wet sand state, and the appearance is like a grainy, non-cohesive, like a wet sand, like a seashore where we have a wet kind of a sand we can see at a seashore. Similar kind of a stage is there, that is called as a wet sand stage. The next stage is going to happen when the monomer is going to mix with the polymer. Then the sticky or the stringy kind of a surface is there. The surface of the particle of the monomer dissolves in the liquid and the mix becomes sticky or the stringy when it is held between the fingers, or then that fingers are pulled apart. They are called as a stringy stage, where the strings can be formed. Third stage, then it is a very important stage for manipulation, that is a dove stage. The dove stage is the where the monomer is more is going to occur, more polymerization occurs in that particular phase. and the homogeneous soft dough-like non-sticky consistency of the moldable mass is prepared. So whenever there is a non-sticky kind of a stage is there, that is called as a dough stage. And most important, packing is done at this particular stage. During the viva and during the spotting also, this question is always asked to the examinees, like at what stage the packing is to be done. Packing is always to be done at the dough stage. The next is the rubbery or the elastic stage, where the monomer disappears by further penetration into the polymer and evaporation. So the mass is cohesive, rubber-like, and it cannot be molded. So it is of no use, because we are supposed to pack the entire material to that particular stage. The next stage is a stiff stage, where the mass become more stiff, and this is of again a useless kind of stage. But as the stages are there, we are supposed to mention the stages of physical stages of polymerization. Types of denture-based resin. There are basically three types of denture-based resin depending on the activation of that particular resin. First one is would be the heat-activated resin. Second one would be the chemical-activated resin, and third one would be the light-activated resin. Heat-activated denture-based resin composition, again the same powder and liquid form. Powder is composed of a pre-polymerized spheres of polymethylene methacrylate dissolved in a monomer, and it reduces polymerization shrinkage. Next one is the initiator in the form of benzoyl peroxide, and it is to provide the free radical. The next step would be the dibutyl phthalate, which is acted as a plasticizer. For radio opacifiers, the barium and the bismuth salts are there. Color pigments are there to have the different colors for the denture-based resin. Like for denture-based resin can range from pink to the slightly reddish kind of a shade. But the basic color would be pink, but the different value and chroma is going to change depending on the addition of color pigments. Various co-polymers are added, which increases the solubility of the powder with the resin, with the monomer, and it reduces the dough forming time and the brittleness. Powder is a transparent resin unless the color pigments are added to it, and it allows to penetrate the ultraviolet range in the range of 250 nanometers. The noob hardness number is around 18 to 20 KHN. The composition of the liquid is like it is a non-polymerized methyl methacrylate monomer. As we know, this monomer is going to make the polymer. And hydroquinone in the range of 0.06%, that is used as an inhibitor. Glycol dimethacrylate as a cross-linking agent. And co-monomers like ethyl acrylates, butyl acrylate, etc. are added in a composition of the monomer. Monomer is a transparent liquid at room temperature with the following points, like boiling point. Here the boiling point is very important. Most of the time, the examiner asks to you like a boiling point of water and boiling point of liquid. That is monomer. You're supposed to know the boiling point of monomer, that is 100.8 degrees Celsius. This is the heat-activated denture-based resin. Again, what is the ratio? The acceptable polymer-monomer ratio is 3:1 by volume and 2:1 by weight. Again, MCQ can be asked to you on this particular point, like what is the polymer-monomer ratio by weight or by volume? You are supposed to know it is 3:1 by volume and 2:1 by weight. This provides sufficient monomer for the polymerization reaction, and then the volumetric shrinkage of that particular polymerized resin can be limited to 7% and 0.5% as a linear shrinkage. The heat-activated denture-based resin is used as a compression molding technique. This is the cross-section for a compression molding technique, where the base is there, over which you can have the cast is there. This is the denture base with the teeth. This is the counter flask, this is plaster, and this is the lid. This is a cross-section of a compression molding technique, where the heat-activated acrylic resin is packed after de-waxing in the mold, which is prepared after the de-waxing of that particular flask. The next one, the heat-activated denture-based resin can also be used as a injection molding technique, where the material is forcefully injected through the channel which is created in the veracity flask. This is a special type of a veracity flask, where the channel for the injection molding technique is used. It is little bit technique sensitive, and the most common kind of technique is heat activated denture based resin. And I am sure most of you must have done this exercise in your preclinical lab. The heat activated denture based resin polymerization cycle is the heating process used to control polymerization. Once the packing is done, then after bench curing, it is supposed to be subjected to polymerization cycle. What is polymerization cycle? It is the heating process which is used to control the polymerization. Different types of curing cycles or the polymerization cycles are available or recommended by the authors by different kind of studies. As first, at a constant temperature of 74 degrees Celsius for 8 hours. The second one would be 74 degrees Celsius for 8 hours and then increasing it to 100 degrees Celsius for 1 hour. Here the word increasing to 100 degrees Celsius is very important. Then the third point is the 74 degrees Celsius for 2 hours and followed by 1 hour, that is followed by 1 hour boiling at 100 degrees Celsius. Here there are generally the examiners ask you what are the different types of polymerization cycle, slow curing cycle and the rapid curing cycle. So the 74 degrees Celsius 2 hours followed by 1 hour is the rapid curing cycle, that is supposed to be the answer. Now next we will discuss about the chemically activated resin. This is also called as autopolymerizing acrylic resin, or in a layman's language it is also called as self-cure acrylic resin. It is again composite available in the form of powder and the liquid. The composition is the pre-polymerized spheres of polymethyl methacrylate, that is to dissolve the monomer and reduce polymerization shrinkage. Again it has an initiator, that is benzyl peroxide, plasticizer in the form of dibutyl phthalate, color pigments, copolymers that increases the solubility of powder and reduces the dough forming time and brittleness. But here one more thing is added, that is called as an activator. In case of a chemical activated resin, the activator is added in the form of NN-dimethyl-p-toluidine. This particular activator is responsible for the initiation of the reaction. In case of a heat cured acrylic resin or heat activated acrylic resin, the heat is required for the activation of the polymerization reaction. But in case of chemically activated resin, and the activator is in the form of NN-dimethyl-p-toluidine is used. The chemically activated resin, the advantages are slightly less volumetric shrinkage is there as compared to heat-cured acrylic resin. The greater dimensional accuracy is there. The manipulation, that is processing or the deep flasking, is relatively easy as compared to heat-cured acrylic resin. But it has a greater amount of unreacted monomer, and that is the reason it has the many disadvantages in the form of the properties of the denture based resin. It has a decreased transfer strength at its control, as it has more amount of unreacted monomer, that is going to change the biocompatibility of this material. This material cannot be used directly in the oral cavity because it has a more amount of unreacted monomer. It has an inferior color stability because whatever the amount of monomer is present, that produces, it's the oxidation of that particular monomer happens in the oral cavity, and that gives an inferior color stability to the chemically activated resin. The chemically activated resin, if you want to go for the fabrication of the denture, then one more technique is described, like the fluid resin technique, where the specialized kind of a flask is used, and the agar is used as a duplicating material, and after this particular duplication of this particular cast has been done after sealing, the this vent is made that acting as a channel to fill the resin, and then again the teeth are properly aligned in this the mold cavity, and the cast is there. And in the next step, that fluid resin is going to be poured by the channel which what we have made in the flask, and then after the removal of that particular reversible hydrochloride, that is agar, you will get the restoration or the denture like this. Next is the light activated resin. What is it? It is a composite resin which is a matrix of urethane dimethacrylate, microfine silica and the high molecular weight acrylic resin monomers. It is where the visible light is acting as an activator and camphoroquinone is acting as an initiator, which is a photo initiator. Most of the time it is nice to know type of a topic, like an examiner asks you, what do you understand by photo initiator? Can you enumerate any photo initiator? Then you're supposed to answer camphoroquinone in a light activated resin or a composite resin is a photo initiator. It is a single component denture based resin supplied in the form of either sheet or a rope, and it is packed into the light proof pouches to prevent the inadvertent polymerization of that particular resin. The light activated resin cannot be flasked in a conventional manner. What we are supposed to go for heat activated and the self cure acrylic resin, self cure or autopolymerizing acrylic resin. But here the teeth are arranged on the denture base and was molded accurately on the cast. Subsequently, that particular denture base is exposed to a high intensity visible light for an appropriate period for polymerization. Here, this type of light activated resin is there, where the either it is available in the form of a rope or a sheet, and then the teeth are arranged in the similar fashion what you are going to do. Then little bit amount of adjustment can be done in the form of waxing, carving and all, and then that entire process is placed in a light cured chamber for the better curing of that particular light activated resin. But what are the properties of the denture-based resin which are important? Like polymerization shrinkage. The polymerization shrinkage is very important, because whenever there is a polymerization, the mass is there would be going to happen a shrinkage. That shrinkage can be vary from heat cure to self cure, and also for self cure to light activated resin. In case porosity. In case of heat-activated resin, the porosities are more as compared to self-care resin. The water sorption, what amount of water that particular denture-based resin can absorb is called as a water sorption. Solubility, practically this particular kind of a material that is denture-based resin after curing is practically impossible for the soluble in water. But a little small nano kind of solubility of that particular material is there whenever the researchers have seen this particular topic. The crazing means the what are the stresses are occurred in this particular denture-based resin. That stresses are going to be seen as a crazing, that is a mechanical stresses that can be seen along the vector lines of the denture-based resin. And the strength in the, is to be considered in the form of compressive strength and the impact strength. Generally, the question is asked to you either SAQ or a part of LAQ, like compare or give the comparison for chemical and heat-activated denture-based resin. The comparison should be done on the basis of activator. Like in case of a chemical cure, the activator is N-dimethylphenidyl, whereas in case of a heat-activated, the heat is activator. Molecular weight of the chemically activated is relatively less, and the heat activity is relatively more. The residual monomer content of the heat chemical cure would be less, heat cure it would be more. Polymerization shrinkage, chemical cure it would be less because the monomer is there, and in heat activated polymerization shrinkage would be more. As the unreacted monomer is there, the strength is less in case of a chemical activated, and in case of a heat activated, the strength is relatively high. May it be a transfer strength, compressive strength or the impact strength. The heat, the strength of the heat activated resin is always superior as compared to chemical activated. Porosity is relatively less in case of chemical activated, and it would be more in case of a heat activated. The distortion, creep and deformation would be more in case of chemical activated as compared to heat activated. Color stability is inferior in case of chemical activated as compared to heat activated. The ease of deflasking. Ease of deflasking is good in case of chemical activated, and it is bad or relatively worse in case of a heat activated. Biocompatibility is, it is excellent biocompatibility with the heat activated and inferior biocompatibility with the chemical activated, because it contains unreacted monomer content is there.